So, that goes back again to what you were talking about too. Like, if you're seeking yourself at the end of the day, that feeling of wanting to be free, like that's natural type deal. Nobody want to get locked up in a cage. You know what I'm saying? Huh. That's real serious.
So
That's
the
real
thing
serious. It's the
is
same thing you're connecting to that will, if you showing love to another person or whatever, like in a natural way, that's that same thing of feeling like you don't want to be caged down, so I'm gonna lie to you and say, oh, I don't know who that is. You know?
so the whole thing is Queso being real to himself, or is he being real to ATK? Or is he being real to what society is telling him to do and say? Which one is it? And does he even know?
It's probably not. It's probably situational. You know, it's like whenever you feel like one is gonna serve you more than the other.
All right, we're back. Ooh, we in the gym. Welcome to EJ's Gym, a guide to elevate your mindset. And you know it. I got my man, little bro. Little bro is a frequent guest on the show. So, the little bro, go ahead and introduce yourself.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome to EJ's Gym. You know what I'm saying? We in here, we about to talk, about to chat it up, trying to learn, trying to make sure we grow. You know what I'm saying? Expand that mindset. How y'all doing?
Man. And you never know, one day we might remix this, and change the name a little bit, get little bro, get his input, you know what I mean? And we, can remix this and have a frequent thing going on. And that's what I'm trying to do. I'm not gonna lie to you. So hopefully we can go ahead and make it happen. And I'm looking for, definitely looking for some engagement in these conversations right here. So, go ahead and hit the like button right there. I'm learning how to do that. That's called housekeeping. I think that's what they call it, housekeeping. Hit the
Housekeeping.
like button, subscribe and share and all that other good stuff. You know what I mean? Go ahead, rock with your boy, rock with little bro. You know what I mean? We
Yes,
over here.
sir.
We about to cook it up. We about to cook it up. So I called little bro the other day and I told him I was, following a few things that was very, very interesting to me. And we always have the conversations about the music and, the lifestyle, the culture. That's what me and little bro, that's what we like to talk about. And I'm not gonna lie, we grew up and, I grew up in Miami, Florida, little bro in Orlando, and we grew up in that culture of what, rap music, hip hop, what do you want to call it, little bro?
Definitely a hip hop culture, as you would say it, right, for
We grew up
sure.
in the hip hop culture, no harm, no foul. That's just what we know. So the whole rap music, if that's what you want to call it, is something that we're into. Growing up, it was a Tupac thing for me. I was into Biggie, Jay-Z, all of those guys. And being from the South in Miami, the Trick Daddy, the Lil
The
Wayne's, the No
Wayne,
Limit,
exactly.
the Cash Money
Right.
Juvenile, and those guys, were a big deal. 8 Ball, MJG, you don't know nothing about that. I picked those guys up from my cousin and all those.
Okay.
But anything from the
Just
South, anything from the, huh? Just a little bit.
made. Yeah, just a little bit. Not too much though. You got me on that one.
Anything, anything from the South. So, what about you? What were you into?
I would say coming up, definitely a lot of Wayne. Wayne was popping for sure at that time. This is like, I'm thinking back to when he had like the Young Money, Cash Money thing going on too. So
Right.
then that's when like somebody like Drake was coming up, who's been around so long now. And shoot, a lot of that, I would say. What else? What else? Definitely Hot Boys,
Hot
Juvenile,
boy,
all
hot
that
boy.
stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Came up on that, definitely.
Okay, so we want to give people some perspective. I'm an 85, I'm an 80s baby, right in the middle, 85. I'm currently 37 right now. So go ahead, and we want to give people perspective so they can understand where we're coming from, how I see it, my perspective, and how you see it. So you go ahead and tell them your age and, you know, your birth date and all of that stuff. Not right. the exact date, but you know what I mean. But,
right. So, yeah, 97. So that would have been, I mean, basically some people would say like 2000s, but, you know, the end of the 90s. So, and I'm 24 now, going on 25.
I was 12. What? Like around 12? Yeah, because you was in October, right? October.
You know.
You're an October baby. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so yeah, you, so 12, right around the time I was born, it was like for your age, when I was born, that's probably around when I started getting into like rap music and stuff, 12, 13. So that would have been like 2000, maybe like 7, 8, 9 type deal. So yeah. It's
wow.
You know?
Right. Yeah, around that time I was in college.
Okay.
I think I was in college around that time.
Mm-hmm.
2007, that's what you said, right?
Right,
and
something like that.
Even before that, when I was your age, I think you said around 97, I started to get into music. And then we might have touched that in another video where I think I told you Busta Rhymes album, one of the first albums that I bought. Or I got okay. my dad to.
That's a series. His first album?
No, that's it wasn't even the first album. It was oh, like okay. I think it was ELE, but at the time, like being a kid, I think before we had tapes, you know, you can record and stuff like that. And then right. you can burn CDs. I used to always like get like people to burn me like
right, right, like a mix.
Like a mix, but to actually mm-hmm. go inside a record store and purchase an album. He mm-hmm. was the first physical album that I actually purchased. But like I said, we did another show when we spoke about that. That
right,
stuff.
Right.
But around that time, I think 12, 13, I think maybe Cash Money was out then. I don't know, that 97, 98. I don't know if they were out then.
I feel like... I mean, I don't want to speak on it because, you know, I was a J. I feel like maybe that would have been like early 2000s type deal.
Yeah, I'm guessing. I'm not sure. But mm-hmm. like I mentioned before, the Tupac and all that, Bone Thugs and Harmony, all of that. I just remember all of that. And just say as a kid, man, not really understanding lyrics and what those words actually mean. Because it's just like we had a conversation about like certain things being like subtle. With, you know, them talking about drugs or talking
right.
about murder, different things like that. And it's not so subtle anymore.
Right, yeah, I think we missed that. I'm thinking back to some of the stuff I used to listen to. Even I missed that little era of people being subtle. Like, you know, the bars was on top. So if you could say something without saying it, the best, you know, then that's who was the top guys. But now you just kind of say exactly what's going on. It's no... hiding behind the bars or whatever, so to speak, you know.
Right, right. And I told you, like, we can talk about, you know, this summer a little bit, you know, and I was, you know, doing my little intern thing at North Carolina Central, helping out with the weight that. Room and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, connecting with the kids and hearing, you know, because if it's just me and, you know, I work with younger kids, and sometimes I do work with older kids, like the high school kids. I hear, I guess sometimes Peterson will bring a speaker out there, but he's just like me, you know, he's my age. So I hear a mixture of songs. So some songs I may not hear in the weight room, you know, Coach TC, big shout out TC down there at Central, would play a different mixture of songs and stuff like that. And I told you, like, when the kids were in the weight room, certain songs that you would hear all the kids just chatting a song and dancing to. Mm-hmm. You could tell the songs that they really vibe with.
Right.
And
especially in the weight room.
Yes, especially in the weight
exactly.
room.
Exactly.
So some of the songs, you know, like I said, you I would hear them over and over. And I'm like, oh, it sounds good, like the beat, the way they put the song together, the vocals, like I said, the way they stack. The vocals
right.
and the ad-libs and the different, you know, all of that stuff. Like, the producer did a good job because it sounds like, to the naked ear, it sounds, not saying it sounds bad at all. To the naked ear, everything just sounds good. Then right. you start to listen to the lyrics. Then I start yeah. to listen to the lyrics.
Because I was going to say, it depends on your taste. But, yeah, exactly. It's the sounds of it. Right.
But... How the thing is, I remember, just like I mentioned to you as a kid, not really necessarily knowing, just kind of singing along. How aware of people? How are people really aware of the lyrics in music?
Mm.
and the music that they're listening to.
Man, I think the landscape is changing so much too, because like you can find your music on like YouTube, you can find it on streaming, and they'll have the lyrics for you, but it's like it's so much music being taken in all the time, you know. Like how you said you had to have somebody burn a CD for you. You know, whereas when I got started, it was just like an iPod, and it was probably, you know, my older brother's iPod, you know, KD or whatever. Shout out KD to, you know, listening to some of his music that he already had, or like, you know, you just add it straight from iTunes or something like that. But yeah, man, the landscape has changed already, and the way we consume music is so much of it. It's funny when you see the people that do pay attention to like comments and stuff like that, and like maybe like on a YouTube video or something. Mm-hmm. The people that pay attention to the lyrics, they'll like leave a comment or something, and it's like a joke or whatever. Like, oh, this is real, you know, this is real bars. They're rapping about their real life, you know?
That's what something I wanted to get into. Big shout out to Vic. I got this from Vic. And he made a comment about art imitate life, or life or does life imitate art? Uh-huh. And I think we're in a position of two things happening, where it was a point of time where it was just like fun talking about dancing and stuff like that.
And then
you had a portion of it that was some storytelling, and then you had a large portion of it that was really fiction. You know, just a lot of people just like you said, putting bars together.
Right.
And now you have a situation where things are kind of flipped, where it's life imitating art, like meaning where people are actually doing what they're talking about, man.
Right. It's almost like even from a different angle too, like what's fiction, like what you said, them like drawing from fiction, right, instead of now kind of real life. What's fiction for somebody else might be like the reality for another person, you know. And so it's like the people that used to maybe rap about, oh, somebody else's life that was doing this, that, and the other, you know, you bring it to light, and these dudes are like, okay, well, that's how I'm living, so let me rap about it, you know.
Yeah, and this is not to knock anybody. This is just to bring awareness to what's going on. Because sometimes I think in life, people can get in a situation of, I want to call it like sleepwalking, where you just need somebody to kind of shake you up a little bit so you can be like, oh, okay, I'm aware now. I see what's going on. And this is just what this is. This is not to condemn anybody. This is not to be judgmental. Because you know, you are what you are who you are, and your environment shapes who you are, believe it or not. But you do have a choice, you know what I mean? And sometimes you need somebody to, like I said, shake you up and make you aware of what's going on in your surroundings. And like I mentioned before, like we're in the weight room and I see the songs that the kids are into. And I know you have a young boy who we talked about, a Shiesty, Pooh Shiesty.
Pooh Shiesty, right.
And a few other new guys, you know, that I don't know if young boy would be in that category.
Okay.
And I don't know of what they call drill music, right? That's what they call it, drill music.
Okay.
Would he be considered...
You said a young boy?
I don't think so.
I don't think so. I mean, usually I think about it from, right, and I think about it from like where people are from and stuff like that. It's different kind of drill music in different areas. I wouldn't say so. No.
Okay. Nah, so, but he is very popular amongst the young kids.
Right.
The Kodaks. I knew Kodak already because, you know, we're from Florida, so the guys that are popular from where we're from, that's kind of...
We get a tap on those guys first. Yeah.
Kodak and what other guys? It's a few other people that I can't think of off the top of my head. But yeah, I was introduced to drill music, and this is where we're getting into life imitating art, or is art imitating life? Like, which one is going on here? Because you have these guys now who are, just like what you said, rapping about the things that they're doing. And a lot of things that they're doing, of course, in rap music has always been that element of committing crimes, you know, that element of, just like you said, not saying it, but saying it, putting your words together of murder or killing someone. But now it's just like a face shot, shoot you in the face shot.
Right. And it's like
those are the bars. Those are the bars, man.
And it's like, are you doing more good? I mean, you know, you gotta be the person that's concerned about it, but like, is it doing more good to be putting those kind of things in the light? Like, are you increasing the likelihood for somebody else to do that? I mean, at the end of the day, like you said, you know, it's always been part of the reality, but is the art, you know, bringing about something positive, or is it making like a negative change, you know?
What I was gonna say is, okay, true what you said, but what is the perspective of the rapper? What is their perspective? Like, what are they trying to do? Like, that's my whole point of really trying to figure this whole drill music thing. Is it something to gain fame?
Right.
Is it something to gain, what do they call it? Like, the clout chasing, like people clout chase. So,
right, like a...
the shock value, they say the craziest thing, so
right, like how people used to say like street cred or whatever, something like that. Like, to I don't know, that's serious. I don't think, at the end of the day though, like with music, somebody has to want to hear you too. And it's like, I like that question, that angle of trying to see it from the rapper's point of view. Mm-hmm. Because like, at the end of the day, you know, if you want to make music, you're gonna you talk about what you know, in a sense, right? Like, if you want to make art, I mean, we've had examples of people talking about other people's life, but as an artist, you know, you show kind of something that's near to you, right? If you talk about it from an art standpoint, you know,
man. And so we both, like, I sent my brother a few videos of a few guys. I think it's mainly the rappers in Jacksonville and the situation with Jay the Youngin, because I think he's affiliated with one of the guys from Jacksonville.
Right.
Jacksonville has its own style. Since we're from Florida, why not?
You know, right.
Jacksonville.
It's pockets everywhere, but like, yeah, just because we're from Florida, it's you know, it's easier to easier to touch on something
Duval.
That you,
even from all the way down there in Dade County, we know about Duval, and okay. You guys are right there in Orlando, so I know,
right, a little bit closer, right?
Yeah. And so I sent you a few videos of a few guys, and they had their own style of drill music. And is there anything that you want to say about what any of the videos that you watched? Because I think I'm going to pull up the few videos that I sent to you, and we can talk about it a little bit.
I think there was one song that you sent me. It was like a sample of that, song we was talking about, like from the White Chicks movie.
Yeah.
You going to pull that one up first?
Yeah. Let me
go, I don't know, man.
Let me pull it up. And let me see if we can, hopefully, like I said, this is a continuous recording
right
here. I might can edit this part out here.
Right.
I'm going to share my screen, and hopefully we can get the sound situated thing going, so where they can hear it, you can hear it, and then it's just still recording type deal.
Okay.
So let me share. You go ahead. All right. So go ahead and talk about your perspective while I pull it up, and then I'm going to share the screen once I have it pulled up.
Definitely. So we talking about which song is it? I want to make sure. Who I Smoke by... Yeah. By it's Queso and a couple other guys. I don't know if all those guys are from.
I think the name of the group. The name of the group is ATK.
Okay. Right. So I've heard a little bit about it, and it's funny too, because like in some of the stuff similar to like the Young Thug situation, they're like, oh, it's not a gang or anything like that. It's like it's a record label, and it's a clothing brand. You know, kind of. All the similar, similar to like the bigger guys who's doing it. But I mean, you know, I'm not gonna lie. I can't speak from the perspective of somebody who like listens to this consistently. I don't listen to too much of this kind of music. I definitely listen to, you know, I still listen to my rap and my hip hop, but I try to stay a little bit. I don't stay as close to a little bit of the, like what you would call drill and stuff like that.
Yeah,
I think you know, certain things will kind of will hit me or whatever. Certain things are good, just like you said, sonically, if it sound good. Like even Jada Youngin, I seen some of his stuff. You know, long rest in peace, Jada Youngin. You know, unfortunately, but seen some of his stuff. And I was like, okay, this actually has like a good sound.
I'm not going front. I think Jit pretty hard, man. I like the way some, you know, I used to work with Green, man. We were around a lot of type of guys.
Different backgrounds, you know? Yeah.
And one thing about music, me personally, I respect the art. Like, so sometimes the sound, just like the lyrics, oh, come on. Sometimes the lyrics will, I might have to.
Wow.
Can you see that?
The time left?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. How did that?
I don't know. That's why. I don't know. I'll, like I said, we're going to, I'll just send another link out and then we can do it again. Can you hear it? Can you hear it?
Start playing it. Go ahead. Nah, I don't hear it anyway.
Ah. All right. So. Let me do this. Let me send you a new link before I even get this going. Since you can't hear it, I think I know what to do. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna send you a new link, and then we'll just kind of pick it up. We'll pick it up on that.
This is not. I feel like, would you run this song back after hearing it the first time?
Nah. This song is just meant to be disrespectful. I don't think. Okay. I don't know what their like complete intentions were completely in the Who I Smoke track, but I think it was just more so to be disrespectful to who they're talking about.
To the people
more so than about. To like play it over and over, because that's all they're talking about is but what let's play the track and let the people listen.
Decide.
Before I give my critique, is almost like a what they call it, like a YouTube review, like we're reviewing it together.
Right. Like a reaction almost.
Reaction. That's what it's called. Like a reaction. Okay, so that's what I was doing. I was sending you a new link. Nothing.
No, I'm not hearing it. Drill time, Zanny. See, so the way I understand drill, maybe I gotta do some more research myself, because I know it's like different kinds of drill, but I thought it was like the kind of beat and stuff like that. Like at first, I know drill was supposed to like come out of Chicago, that Chief Keef wave, that movement, Chief Keef, Lil Durk, those guys, whatever. But I just thought it was like drill, like as in like what they were talking about. But then I found like New York drill, which is like a whole different set. You know, one of my boys from New York, that's like a whole different set of music, but it's like the beats and stuff like that. I guess it's like a certain kind of trap.
And I need to change my microphone. I would say like from what I know, and I could be wrong, I don't know. Like I said, I'm new to this, you know, I'm a new guy, you know. I thought it was just a style of music of talking about, like, remember I told you, they said, like in this one, Who I Smoke, where they talk about smoking on people and the people that they killed. I know a lot of people say the ops think in their music now, but they talk a lot about their rivals. The rivals,
okay,
and what they do to them, and that's what I thought. As me gathering information is watching these guys, hearing the guys from Chicago, from Memphis, because this guy's from all over.
Just like this guy's from Memphis too, and their stuff is considered drill too.
Oh yeah,
you know,
some of it is.
Nah, I see what you're
like
saying.
Like Pooh Shiesty, right? We need to be drill.
Right. Yeah. I don't know if that's drill though.
I mean, I could be wrong. I don't know.
I'm thinking I'm wrong because I feel like that makes more sense. But I know I know there's some like sonic stuff that could be drill, like what the beat sounds like and stuff. But then there's also like the content matter, which seems like some people call drill too. Definitely.
Yeah. stuff it does for me. I don't know why. That's weird. I should be able to put a video up and everybody can hear it.
Let me see.
We're going to watch who I smoke first.
All right. Let me turn it. I guess I could turn it down and do
let me see what I can do.
When I see you, I'ma push your shit back, boy. Time to get spit through your set, we don't fight, boy. 12 paramedics couldn't save your fucking life, boy.
I'm gonna say 12 paramedics couldn't save your life.
That's how we strike, boy. Let's ass in the street, this the end of your life, boy. Stay your ass, see a flashlight and it's nice, bro. These niggas saw as hell, all these niggas, they just act hard. I'ma shoot this bitch when I motherfucking see you. I don't go nowhere without my motherfucking heat, cool. Smoking on the PD, I was smoking train D2.
Can you pause it? Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
He said smoking on Lil Trey and smoking. I don't know if he said Lil D2. So I'm guessing, I don't know if it's just they're saying it in their music or does that mean that they killed that person?
Yeah, I don't know who he said Lil Pootie and then Trey D. They even put his name across the thing. I wouldn't imagine that's somebody that
these guys are disrespectful, man. Let's just keep it real, man.
Nah, for sure. even if these are people that just died, like if you had nothing to do with it, nah, for sure.
I know, right? Go ahead and play it.
All
right. I'll just mess with the sound when that play. I'll try to put a video or put like adjust the sound where the video matches up so they can hear and see it.
Yeah, if you can put Sam over it, no, for sure.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And just put our critique over. I can mess with it. I'll be able to play with it.
All right.
Yeah.
Max to that motherfucking for you. Knock a nigga out, boy, you can get your ass beat too. Look, oh, you tripping, baby girl, I don't need you. You could walk 1,000 miles and I still don't wanna see you. I got the whole city scared, these niggas know what we do. Ooh, I smoke, baby.
Pause. Remember, okay, pause. So we're gonna get into the queso guy and hopefully we can get the sound stuff situated, or like I said, I'll play with it. Now, Bibby is like the main star of the guys that they call out who's dead.
Okay.
The dead ops, right? So my thing is, right, this is the ATK group, right? So this means they're admitting that their group killed Bibby and I guess whoever Tiki is next. That's the rhyme. That's what it sounds. I don't know. Somebody's mm-hmm. next. I've heard this song several times. You know, and they're, it seems like they're having fun talking about it.
Right. On the golf course, having fun.
Now, did I miss something? Like I said, you're younger than me. I'm 37. You know, I still like the music. I still like the sound. I think they're creative. It's just kind of weird of what they're using to create the music, like the topics that they're using. But like, what am I missing something? Why is that entertainment?
It's I'm thinking about it, right? And maybe I could like put it in a way almost like relating it to being on the field, right? Like, mind you, you have, you know, somebody that's a opponent, that's a different level of like, you know, enemy, depending on who you are, right? You have your guys with you, you know what I'm saying? And you and your guys are the best guys to you. You get what I'm saying? So like you know how if you have that one team and you don't like those guys, so sometimes y'all talk shit about them, but at the end of the day you got to see them on the field, you know, like these dudes, I guess if you're around your people and they hyping you up on the same thing, then they'll, you know, even getting disrespectful don't matter if you feel like your team is the best, you know.
I get it. Okay, I get some of it, not all of it. Just from a football perspective, we both play sports too. So that's another mm-hmm. angle we can kind of take it as. And you played on a really good team. Mm-hmm. I played on a really good team in high school, college, medium. We went back and forth. We had good seasons, bad seasons, blah, blah, blah. But I get what you're saying. Like in high school, as far as like having a rival, like Miami Northwestern was our rival. I went to Miami Central, Jackson, Kara City, those type teams, right? And most of the time, because of like
zoning or location, some of those guys that's at Northwestern, I probably went to elementary school with, which
I did.
A couple guys, you know, we grew up, or middle school, we went to middle school together or something like that. And I remember, like, before, I didn't say my senior year, and I would think it was Makai, I think, what was Makai's last name? Seals? He was one of the top, I think he led the county in sacks, maybe okay. The junior to senior year. And I knew Makai, I think we went to elementary, I think it was middle school we were cool in middle school. And before the game, we would talk trash, but we didn't have the Twitters and then this, that, and the third. But it was nothing but love. It was like a friendly trash talk. Mm-hmm. Now, when we were in the game, I tried to crush him.
Exactly.
He actually got a sack on me. You know what I mean? But the next play, I drove him like 30 yards. And I said, never again.
Not again.
And then we were at it the whole game. But after the game, you know what I'm saying? We boys. You know what I'm saying? We boys. So I get it. But you know, football, we may have that heat of the moment battle, and then at the end of it, it's like a respect thing. You know what I mean?
Definitely. Now, that's what's missing in this equation.
That's what's missing. That's why I keep saying it's disrespectful. Right. Because if you think about it, and I'm not getting down in too deep, I don't really know these guys. We're speaking from an outside perspective, but we're just trying to bring awareness to what's going on here from what we know, from what our perspective, our lives, and what we seen. And to be, and I guarantee you, just looking into it as we get into it, the ATK and the KTA guys literally live right down the street from each other.
Meaning,
the other guy looks just like you.
Right.
You know what I mean?
It's always beef with the people that's across the way, for sure.
Like, where did that come from, and why do we have a lack of respect for each other? Because just like you hit it right on the head, it's a respect thing. Because mm-hmm. that's just like truly disrespectful to the families and the people that come up in those communities who work hard to build those communities. Because you just kind of take away their babies and you have no regard for human life.
Yeah, and I think you learn that in sports too, because it's like, or at least in football, you know, you out there hitting people at the end of the day, and like, that's your job to be doing that. And so, like you said, at the end of it, you know that person just came to do what they came to do, and you came to do what you came to do. At the end of it, you shake hands, you leave the field. You know, that respect is kind of something that you learn in sports. You know.
So my thing is, if these guys literally live down the block from each other, where did they learn these behaviors?
That kind of leads me into what we was talking about a little bit earlier too, with the Queso situation, and because I don't know, you would think like the way they paint a lot of the young black dudes and stuff like that, and like, oh, if you're willing to like do crime and stuff like that, you know, you probably don't have no dad or no mom, whatever, you know, some sort of messed up family situation. But then you see, there's even situations where, like, you know, the parents kind of are around, or are at least, like, I don't want to say involved, but they're, like, around while this stuff is happening, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
There has to be some sort of, like, learned, that respect aspect is probably part of what's not getting passed down, you know?
Right, because at the end of the day, regardless of how they felt about Bibby or whatever he did to disrespect their crew, he still has a mother, he has a father, he has a brother.
You ever heard people say don't disrespect the dead too? I've heard that like phrase before.
And this is like I said, I don't want to speed into it, but like the young guy was very talented, but as I listened to his music, it's like he was wishing death upon himself. The youngin guy.
Really?
Yeah, I'm just saying, we're gonna get into it,
but
it's just like, We can get into the lyrics. Like I'm saying, I'm just listening to the words and what they're saying, like things like come outside, or said something. I think he said something about who's going to be the first person in the city to get me. I don't know what does that mean? You know what I mean? Like, did he put a own hit on his own head by saying that? I don't know. Like I said, they're the one rapping the lyrics. I guess they put it out there and we can interpret it however we like. You know what I mean? Like,
Queso can talk about running people down and shooting them with a gun and running and jumping hurdles. And it just so happened that they have a case where they were running and jumping fences.
And jumping fences. Just like so, you said, is it the art imitating life or life imitating the art?
Where is it right here? Like, it's just right. Two things going on where these guys are creating art, but are they living these lives? And just from what's going on as far as like with the interrogations and the murders, right. Like Bibby is actually dead. You know, as people are dancing to this song, and it's just like an anthem for how many people they killed. Hmm. You know what I mean? And like, right. That's the thing is my question is to these guys, if I could ask them, where's the respect for the families? And they probably don't care. You know what I mean? But to each his own, you live your life however you want to live it. But, you know, is one thing about where we are, you have to be aware of the energy that you put out, because the energy you put out will come back to you. That's the same right. thing that, you know, will come back tenfold.
It like you said, yeah, you put that energy in the air about somebody coming to get you, and then you manifest that negativity into your life, you know?
That's what I was talking about with Jay, because I was, like I said, I haven't heard all of his songs, but a mm-hmm. lot of those music is him, like the Queso guy. I think they made music about stepping on people, and a song with the Bibby, and like, I mean, they're talking about killing people. I know, I've been on both sides. Yes, I'm educated, but I do come from the inner city of Miami, so I understand. I don't even have to be around Florida to figure out what certain things mean when I'm listening to music.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I can be like, oh man, that's what he's talking about. That's why right. when I told you when I never really understood or never really heard the spoken thing, because I never listened to the Chief Keef or any of the drill guys from the Chicago. So when they start talking about this and they say smoke, and I'm like, oh, that's what they're talking about. Actually, like killing people,
right?
And I'm like, when did that really become a fad, like a real thing? Like, because I thought before, I used to think the rappers were fake, they weren't really, you know, doing it, killing people like that. Some, not all, majority. Now, man, you got Young Thug get locked up in a RICO case. You're like, man, hold on, are these dudes really doing these things that they're talking about now?
So then is there, like, so we talk about like music and the art, right? I think I might have asked you something like this before too. Like, are you somebody that believes that like an artist, and not, let me not say like a rap artist, whatever, but artists in general, somebody who's making art, they have the responsibility of like what kind of influence that art could have? Are you one of those people that like believe that they should think about that beforehand, or you just make your art and you let it, you just kind of let it do what it does?
Okay. How can I answer that? It's a situation where, how can I put it? Where I think you just have to be aware of the effects of your footprint on the environment. And I would put it like this, like you wouldn't go in a rainforest and just start lighting matches and fires and just burning trees and stuff like that. You know,
okay.
And, you know, you wouldn't just go in there just playing around and potentially start a fire type deal.
Right, you're not, yeah.
Meaning you're gonna take care of the environment. So, or take care of what's around you. You're aware of not harming the environment, things to do. You're aware mm-hmm. of the things that you do that harms the environment. Okay. So I would say, yes, we all have a responsibility. If you are aware of your behaviors, that the energy that you put out, what it can potentially like do to someone else. Like just say for me, for instance, even doing stuff like this, I like stuff like this, but I know the mm-hmm. space that I'm usually in, working with kids, younger kids, kids with autism, they're not going to look at this. This is for a different type of audience when me and you
Okay.
You know, when we talk about this, this is for, you know, the people who are into this type of stuff, the music, the sports, the people that's my age, around your age, or right in between.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I know this won't have a necessarily a negative effect on people. It'll just make them think a little different about what they're, you know, looking at. So I think you have to be aware of your footprint, or like what's going to happen as you create what you create. Meaning, like, I know, if I personally, if I go out there and if someone, just say if someone, I don't even want to put myself in there, goes out there and commits a murder.
Okay.
One, you know, first off, regardless if you do it in rage or what, that's not my space. So I don't know the headspace of that type of person. But you go out there and you do something like that. One, you're going to, just like we said, you're going to affect the family. You're going to affect all the people that interact with that person. One.
Right.
Two, to go on, first off, to know what you did, right? Knowing that.
Right.
Second off, to go in the studio to take energy and time to talk about it. Over and over and over and over and over again, whatever your intentions are, whether it was to disrespect that person, they're dead now. I mean, I don't know. Like, what are they gonna do? Like, oh man, that's a good rap, man. Yeah, you got me.
You put salt in the wounds of the other people too, like the family members and stuff that you're talking about every time you do that too.
And the crazy thing is, as you see this guy Ace with the thing, and I tell you, I respect him as an artist. He was the first one that I actually heard his music before I even knew what was going on. I'm not gonna lie, I heard one of his songs, I put it on my playlist, and one day I was like, let me see this guy. I saw a video and it had a whole bunch of guns. I was like, I never want to watch another video, one of his videos again. I was like, I'd rather just hear the song. Yeah, because it was just kind of weird. Like, to me, I see it now, not been watching it more since we're talking about this, but it's weird to me. Like, these guys are like, this is cool.
It's not
like,
natural, right?
And it's one track. Matter of fact, is this guy? His name is Hot Boy, and I don't know if he may be from Orlando, and he was,
I want to say he's from Orlando,
right? And he says something about in a track that this Glock looked good with every outfit. To who?
You know,
what I'm talking to you about before, like I said, I don't want to steer off too much. I want to know, what did I miss? Where did it happen?
The in between, so right? Okay.
Yeah, I see in between, what you're and how everything just happened so fast, where
right,
like the gun thing is, it's a fad, it's a trend, it's a, you know what I mean? I wear my clothes and it
exactly
looks good.
And the reason
in the videos, remember the girls used to be in the video. Oh, I'm looking at the chicks.
You know, yeah.
And
asked you about that's different. You see, I didn't want to get into that. But the reason I asked you about the responsibility question and like the art and stuff like that, because I really feel like part of that is like the standards for what is art and for like who is an artist, I guess, kind of change in that way too, you know. So like, because anybody could get it, and at the end of the day too, like, you're a rapper, you putting words over the beats, like you know, there's guys who used to make their own beats, and there's guys who used to, like, you know, they spent all their time in the studio when you had to like record your stuff on an actual tape. So like, if you get it wrong once, you got to go back and do it again. You get what I'm saying? So, like, I think a big part of it is just that, like, the standard kind of changes for the art and stuff like that. So maybe that, like, who you calling an artist, that responsibility kind of goes out of the window or whatever.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah, man. Like, I think you have to be cognizant of your behaviors. And like I say, your footprint, because your footprint, well, I say that is people can follow, right? And you can't lead people into a ditch, not a ditch, a quicksand, a cliff, fire or danger. You know what I mean? Like, say, for instance, right, like I was mentioning, this guy Ace here, he has a mother, you know, the crazy thing is, he was in a situation where he had, and I don't know how deep you got into the story, he had three people that got shot, and he got shot as well. And he knows the feeling of what his mom felt like when he lost his little brother. He knows the feeling of what his friends' mothers feel like by losing his friends. So you're just going to inflict that same pain on somebody else. And they're gonna, it's just like a continuous cycle over and over and over. And I think because they're so young, you know, and then I know we're jumping around, they're in that group think space of where,
I was just about to say, what are you, how do you know you're leading somebody into a fire at 16, 17, 18? You know what I'm saying? If you, if somebody is willing to pay you to like put that on a track or whatever, how could you say that it's wrong? You know, how could you personally say that it's wrong to yourself when somebody is willing to throw you a couple racks, you know, to do it, to get up and do that?
You got to be able to tap in, man. Like, even, I don't know, like I said, I'm 37 now. I'm not their age. I didn't grow up in Jacksonville. I did grow up in Miami. It was something very similar, but different. I would say different. I was not going to put myself in the same space as these guys. I'm not going to do that. They probably come from something completely different, but similar, because it's Florida. You know what I mean? And we know how that flow goes. Depending on where you grow up in Florida, but if you're in the inner city, it's
let's highlight depending on where you grow up, because we can't keep spreading the Florida. If there's anything we're gonna do with this is to pull back on some of the craziness that's coming out of Florida that they keep attaching us to, because not everybody, you know, not everybody is you know what I'm saying, is in that situation. So
no, everybody's not in that situation. But I tell you what, coming out of Dade County, I've seen some crazy things and people crazy things and some crazy behaviors. This is why this is so interesting to me, because I've always wondered, you know, what would happen. What happens when you make that decision to go this way? And I know we didn't get into my high school experience and what I've experienced in the choices in the environments that I was around, but those options were there. They were there, you know what I mean? So the thing is, like, you still have a choice and you still have a responsibility as a person, as a human being, for the people behind you, which are the kids that are listening to this music, not to go into that and lead them to a ditch. But just like you said, how do you know? You have to tap into your heart, man. You got to tap into your heart space, man. You going around blowing people's faces off. How does that feel? I don't know. Nah, it cannot be a good feeling.
Yeah, I think we all wired to have that feeling. Like, at the end of the day, you come from people. You grow up around people. I don't think nobody wants to. Nobody has that desire to just like off somebody, you know what I'm saying? Naturally, there's no way. There's no way.
I tell you what, as I listen to some of these guys in their interviews, and we're gonna play this, let this last 2 minutes play, is these guys get on, you know, drugs and pills, you know, and I don't know, maybe that I don't do the pills thing. So I don't know what that is. And I don't know what other drugs these guys are on, but I know they do the lean and that. And I don't know if that changes or alters your behavior to kind of suppress that feeling that you get to not do something like that.
I think at the end of the day, too, all of it, all of it is suppression, like, to a certain degree, whatever your drug of choice is, by, like, a lot of guys at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. If you feel like you got to feel different to do something, you know what I'm saying, then it's you're trying to step outside of yourself. You're trying to step away from yourself, not closer in, you know?
Yeah.
For sure.
Go ahead and play it. We're going to have to do another link so we can keep it rolling, but go ahead and play it. See what we get. See, you got it on. I know you got it on max on your end, so I'm gonna just go ahead and turn it up on my end. So
it's loud over here for sure. We're gonna play the rest of it.
All right.
We gon' spin a few times like 2-3, but 2-3 let our rhyme till you die. Jump out that shit with sweet till we find out the drop, find out what I'm for.
Every time I hear it, I'm like,
you ain't listen to the whole thing, did you?
I am. He's talking about things that he's done.
No, I was. I looked. Your face looked like you hadn't heard all the way into that verse yet.
I heard it, but I didn't like. I heard it just like I would stop like when I hear like I don't know like towards the end part. So I never really hear everything that they're saying, but just like listening to what he was talking about. Oh, shooting him, and he didn't die, and he went on alive, and he was like, right. "Oh my God!" I'm like, "Did that really happen?"
You know, regardless, yeah. If you you know too much type deal, even if you wasn't there, you know too many details about the situation.
And that's what we want to get into, and I definitely want to get into Queso before we get up out of here. Go ahead and play it, and then I'm gonna send you another link. It's giving me 3 minutes. I'm gonna send you another link. We're gonna jump right back into it. They're having a good time, bro. This is crazy. I'm about to stop this shit here. Where is it? Wow. It's there we go. Oh man, like wow. So what's your perspective on everything with that, with the Who I Smoke? That was the first video I sent you.
My perspective. I just hope that I don't want nobody to incriminate themselves, but we see that's already happening a little bit. So it's already past the point of no return on that one, you know?
No return, bro. As none whatsoever.
Day, you know.
But why do you think why did they do that?
I don't have too much background on these guys. Mm-hmm. Like you said, it just sounds, this is not even the same. Yeah, they keep talking about Bibby, this Bibby guy. It is not even the same group of dudes. Like you said, just being disrespectful.
They are a gang. They are a gang.
So they like all click up. Okay, so they kind of all just talk about the same people.
Right. And the Jay, and that's why I was telling you, the Jay guy was friends with Ace. So, yeah. So, he got right on the whole Bibby train. Like just talking about
stuff.
Yeah, that's why I said
He's not even from Florida too. I seen he's from like Louisiana. Okay, so that's a real serious point too. I see we only got a little bit left too, but it's like, man, even if you weren't involved in the situation, you could just get caught up in the hype or whatever. And who's to say like somebody don't pull up on you just because they seen you talking about, oh, I smoke such and such.
Yeah.
All right. You know what I'm saying? And it goes two ways.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I see it.
Yeah, you got it?
Yeah.
I'm going to start playing it. It's crazy.
Yeah. Maybe a good thing is low. We can just look at the images and catch some of the words.
Real quick, too. Notice all these songs are like 2 minutes. Maybe a little bit less too. Yeah.
There go Ace. He's smoking on something. Step on something. And Scotty is in this video too. Pause. He said, all my ninjas about that murder, we jumping fences like it's hurdles.
Is that what he said? Jumping fences?
You can rewind it.
Wow.
You have the power to rewind.
Foreshadowing.
Not foreshadowing, it happened. This is why they're talking about it.
We chase your ass down, we jumping fences like they hurdles. We stand up every we'll chase your ass down, we jumping fences like they hurdles. Wow. Yeah. I mean, that's a
Scotty right there. Look to his right. That's the right. Scotty. Yes.
Yeah,
his right or what left, whatever. Yeah.
It might be flipped for you, but yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You gonna keep playing?
Yeah, keep playing.
You caught that one?
Go ahead. What did he say?
He said, I fell in love with killing. What did he say? I know these hoes will hurt you.
You got the power to rewind. We're just reacting to it.
Wow.
You have the power to rewind.
I'm going to keep it going. We're about halfway.
That's it's only crazy. A 2-minute video, one minute and 56 seconds.
Yeah.
That's Scotty right there again. These are kids, bro. None of these guys are older than 25.
Nah. No.
None of these guys are older than 25. Maybe the people behind the scenes that's running their business or whatever, or helping them out, but none of these guys is flashing these guns and this prop money or whatever they got going on.
Right.
Maybe it's not prop money. Maybe it's real money. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're none of them older than 25. And my man said he fell in love with the murder, and they got guns with the beams. And where are they getting this stuff from?
It's so funny, like. It's so easy to do something like that. Like, what do you learn? You know, like you said, none of these dudes is even 25 yet. Like, where they get this stuff from? You know.
But go ahead, go ahead and keep playing it. Man, rest in peace, young guy. Young guy has some talent. Young guy has some good energy. Maybe directed towards the wrong thing, but
I said, I don't know about that last line.
I'm not talking about this song. Just talking about the fact of being able to, he figured out how to make his sound where people would like it.
People want to listen to it.
People want to listen to it, like, regardless of what the content is. Meaning, so he has something in him that he just kind of directed the energy the wrong way. My perspective. It's just my perspective. Go ahead. You can jump out of your screen sharing. I'm going to screen share something. I don't want to screen share this. All right, so we talked about this here. Right, the whole Bibby situation, right?
Right.
And
that's the third outside of this album cover, that's like the third Bibby reference I done seen across their stuff too. Burning the Jersey, that's a pretty good one.
Right. That's crazy. And the kid's dead. He's dead.
Right.
That's like three songs we said, like three different reasons and stuff
They either,
pretty sure they have more.
Either they're getting so much publicity from that one case that it's like, oh, let's keep feeding this, or they just like really did not like bro, really had problems with bro. I don't know. I feel like it's the first one more likely, the former more likely. Like they see that it's getting buzz. With the Bibby stuff, my goodness, man. The man got the jersey on him.
And the name of the thing is Violent Child, right?
Right.
So what does this mean? What is Queso trying to say?
violent child, what does that say?
And he has on a baby shirt. Yeah. He has a violent child on. And he's going through a case. He's going through a case right now. So I just hope these guys understand what they have going on with themselves, right?
Absolutely.
So is he incriminating himself is the question I'm asking you.
I mean, at the end of the day, I'm not no expert in the legal system, but like, it takes a certain kind of, you gotta be involved in something to say, oh, you fell in love with killing type shit like that. You get what I'm saying? Like, that's not something that you hear every day. I don't know. The rap, ultimately, rap is about like entertainment and a show, right? But also too, there's a level. Like the way some of these guys carry themselves, you know, like it's almost like the entertainment part doesn't matter, you know, like the entertainment is just an extra perk, you know. It's like, where does this come from for real?
Right. So just like what you said, man, and it's plenty of stuff that, you know, I can put up there. Where, you know, Queso is talking about running down and shooting people and stuff like that. And in this one situation, that kid Bibby, it just so happened in that case, he was chased. Somebody chased him and shot him. And they stood over him and shot him some more.
And right, okay, I think I know which case this is. It was two people at this time, right?
I think they got killed except the same way. But okay. From what you know.
Nah, I was saying, I think from that case, one of the dudes ended up getting away or something like that. But yeah, the Bibby guy you talking about, right? Like, stood over him and shot him again or something like that.
Mm-hmm. And so what I'll do, and I'll add that part so we don't have to mess with the video. I'll just kind of pause this part and add that part. But it was a part where, like, you know, when you talked about like this whole glorifying the death of this kid Bibby or whatever the case, maybe, and pretty more it's other people that I'm pretty sure they're doing that, you know, or saying their little ops or raps and dead ops, whatever the case may be.
Right.
But now Queso gets, you know, because of he did a lot of, not him, I don't know. Let's just say what the case is.
Everybody is innocent until proven guilty.
Innocent, right? Until proven guilty, right? But I think because of some evidence and because of, you know, it was done in broad daylight. Scotty's in jail and Queso is as well, right?
Right.
And in one of the cases, like I mentioned to you, the police officer, you know, these guys are talking about Bibby and this, that, you know, step on something. And we just saw the thing with the Jay Youngin and the burning the jersey and the picture with the violent child and everything else, right?
Right.
And I'll show the part of interrogation and stuff like that. It's something called Crime Circus. Shout out to Crime Circus. I love those videos. Some pretty cool videos. While in that interrogation room, the guy pulls up, the police officer pulls up a picture of the Bibby kid.
Our investigation that we're conducting.
What is this, sir?
Let me show you some pictures of what we're talking about. You know what that is?
No, sir.
You don't know what that is? Bibby ring a bell to you?
You want your lawyer, so I can't tell you no more, but you'll be in trouble.
And he slides the picture over to Queso and he asks Queso, do you know who this is?
Do you know who this is?
And Queso said, no.
Right.
Wait 1 minute. Just like I asked you yesterday, and we'll get closer to wrapping this part up, right?
Right.
If these guys are getting famous off of these murders and everything that they
quote unquote, their gang is committing, regardless of who they're claiming it. Because they're saying it, right? Who I smoke, that means I smoke, baby, just like you said in the song, the video, the violent child.
Right.
So why wouldn't the officer gave him the thing like, yeah, that's who we smoke. I'm smoking on Bibby. You want to smoke it too? Why didn't he say that?
Hmm.
Why didn't he own up to it? They got so famous off of it. Why not own right. it then when you're sitting in front of the officer?
When it's real, when it becomes, I mean, it's real the whole time, but then it's the consequences, I guess. You know what I'm saying? You're not thinking about the consequences because... That's wild. That's right in front of you. You know how they say, like, I've heard something about, like, how you, like, you change your name in like, a, they change your name in a gang, like, they change the language and stuff like that, and, like, how that could change the way, once you change the way people speak and the way that they associate terms, like, you change the way they think about stuff. You get what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
You could use something like smoke for somebody now, obviously, in their situation. That boy said he fell in love with killing. That's different. You know what I'm saying? That's putting it out in the open, but like the language around it, it changed the way you think about stuff like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. And then the thing is, he's manifesting that at the same time. You know what I mean?
So right.
Yeah, he's saying it, and then you repeat it. Remember what I said? The world is your mirror, so it's that cycle. You put it out, then you get it back. You put it out, then you get it back, and you put it out, right. You get it back. And you got to think about the energy that they're putting out. You know what I'm saying? Just like we said, Rip J, I say he was a very talented guy from the snippet of information I've had of some of his work. I'm not going to go look at and listen to all of his music. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But the stuff that I've seen, the visuals and stuff like that. Now, like I said, I don't do the gun things, but these guys had an eye for catching people's attention, right? Maybe the gun thing was part of it. You know what I mean? But the energy that you're putting out, you're talking about people that are brutally murdered.
You know, and on a real tip too, like being so I was in the Marine Corps for 4 years. I don't know if your audience knows that. Like I was in the Marine Corps, and so you know, being over like a lot of veterans or whatever, people associate like there's a problem sometimes with some veterans that come back from wars and they'll have like what's called PTSD. And stuff like that. And these guys, like, it's funny because these guys are like glorifying this stuff, and in reality they're probably having to deal with like seeing stuff like that over and over again and stuff, and like it's a serious issue that people have to deal with. It's funny how you could come from it at like with in a situation like that, like it's not real, but then when you're in an interrogation room or something like that and the reality of the situation comes out, it's a whole nother thing. You know what I'm saying? It's crazy to see like people glorifying stuff like that. In reality, when it's also people that kind of have to do it because of their job, and you don't lose that. You know what I'm saying? That stays with you for the rest of your life type deal, you know?
Right. Yeah, man, I don't understand. Like, if you're going to, like what I said to you the other day, if you're going to be it through and through, meaning not saying that, like, I condone that type of behavior because I don't. That's why we're talking about it.
Right.
But at the same time, like, if you're going to be bold enough to get on camera to burn, we know the thing is the symbolizing thing. We know
symbolism,
what that
right.
symbolism. We know what the symbolism behind burning his jersey. We know the symbolism behind saying you smoked on the guy. We know, I mean, we know what it means.
Right.
So if you're owning it in that fashion and making money off of it, and you know, when you're making these videos and these tracks and stuff like that, like, my question is, why not be that same person sitting at that table with that officer? Then you're that character through and through. It's nothing we can say. We'd be like, okay, right. Queso is just hardcore. He's crazy. He doesn't give a you know what through and through.
Right.
Obviously, he gives a. You know what I'm saying.
Right.
Because if he did, if he really didn't, he'll be like, nah, I'm smoking on Bibby. He wants to be free.
So, that goes back again to what you were talking about, too. Like, if you're seeking yourself at the end of the day, that feeling of wanting to be free, like, that's natural type deal. Nobody want to get locked up in a cage. You know what I'm saying? Huh. that's real serious.
So the thing is,
it's the same thing you're connecting to. That will, you know, if you showing love to another person or whatever, like in a natural way, that's that same thing of feeling like you don't want to be caged down. So I'm gonna lie to you and say, oh, I don't know who that is. You know.
So the whole thing is Queso being real to himself, or is he being real to ATK? Or is he being real to what society is telling him to do and say? Which one is it? And does he even know?
It's probably not. It's probably situational. You know, it's like whenever you feel like one is going to serve you more than the other.
And I think that's the space of where it's challenging for kids in certain environments. And I'm not blaming the environment, because the environment is what it is. You still have choices within that environment. It's no way you're telling me that every single person that comes from Duval that's from that space, right, of wherever the ATK, right, the KTA guy.
Because these are extremes. This is not how everybody is living over there. Exactly. These are extreme cases.
Very, 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 very extreme. Well, you have pockets of people living a certain way, and then you got pockets of other people living a completely different way. It's like that parallel universe type deal.
Right.
You know, and you choose your fate. And I truly know that's what happens in life. And we had the conversation for me and my cousins and how I grew up and my family and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I truly know from looking back at my life that you truly have a choice. Somewhere, somehow in your life, life will give you an out. It'll give you an opportunity to get away from whatever situation that is, that you were, the environment that you grew up in. Life will give you a way out of it.
The same struggle and pain that a lot of these young rapper guys talk about too in some of their music at the end of the day. That's what they say fuels like all this killing and all this rage that they got in them. Nah, for sure.
Yeah, but you got other people, other pockets of people who grew up right next to them who are not like that.
Right, right.
So that means it's a choice. You're choosing to kind of, in a sense, be a certain way. But the whole thing is why are you choosing to go that route? Why are you choosing to fall in love with killing? Because in order to fall in love with killing, you have to see somebody get killed.
Even if it's not you, like it has to have some sort of like you get some sort of emotion out of it.
Meaning like maybe you seen somebody do it, or you around and witnessed one and you was like, okay, shoot, I want to do that too. Meaning like it became something that was a fad or popular around you, and you saw people doing that and you fell in love with it. Because at the same time, me and you, we can both watch a film on TV and watch people get murdered and be like, nah, man, I fell in love with murder. I want to go out there and murder. No, you're detached. Mm-hmm. You're not going to connect.
Right,
with
exactly.
That. It's just a movie.
It's a screen, right.
But the moment you're in a situation and you can connect with the experience, meaning you've been around the experience, or maybe you've experienced the experience, just like you said, maybe you were the one murdering somebody. Because, you know, maybe he got a rush from it. I don't know, man. That's just kind of like, the thing is, I don't want to call the behavior weird. That's like not the right word to use it, but that's unusual behavior. That's an unusual behavior to fall in love with. It's a different type of person that falls in love with something like that. Something as cruel as that, because I think at a certain point, even though they're still in that group think phase, you know because when it happens to you, like meaning to somebody close to you, you know what it feels like.
Right. No, absolutely. There was a case I looked up before. I guess they were, it was himself. I'm talking about Queso. And then like, I don't think he was there when it happened. But I know like his father or something like that. I believe like his half brother had died. Like there was an incident after a show or something, and then the car got shot up and everything. So yeah, it's not like that trauma is not all around them. You know what I'm saying? Like, you felt that before, to lose somebody to an issue, especially to somebody getting shot. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Where, how do you get to the point, though, where you feel like the only way is to, like, get back at them the same way, you know?
It's, I think it's that situation of the group think, it's that situation of the environment. It's that situation of kind of putting yourself in a position where you only have one answer, where that's not actually reality.
There's never just one answer.
It's never just one answer, bro. Never just one answer.
That's the basis of, like, all of it, I feel like, because even, and if I'm being honest, like, personally, as somebody who's in that age group, that, like, 25, you know what I'm saying, sometimes it's easy to kind of get caught up in thinking, like, well, this is the way that things are, so the way I have to do this is either A or B, but it's never really an A or B option. Even on tests, you get four options, you know what I'm saying? So it's like,
you definitely always, you definitely always have a choice. You have multiple options. You know, now you may narrow down your options because of your environment, and you may not be aware of the other options that you have. But the whole thing in life is the whole discernment and understanding yourself, and, like I told you before, and learning how to tap in self. And we had a quick discussion. We're just using this situation to kind of paint a picture of understanding how to be aware in life. And with Queso, I gave you the scenario of, is he being loyal to himself? Is he being loyal to ATK? Or is he being loyal to what society is telling him? And we all go through that, especially the kids, when they're in the young space of going through that, figuring out, like, okay, who am I? Who should I be loyal to? And I think you should always be loyal to self, because if you're loyal to self, self does not, just like you said, self does not want to put self in the cage, right? Meaning where you have restrictions, where you can't do anything. So before you go ahead and commit that crime, self would probably tell yourself, like, ah, that's not a good thing to do. So from there, then on, like, if self is telling, if you're telling yourself, or you're listening to yourself and it's telling you not to do that, after a while, it's going to tell you not to hang around those people, because they're the ones that's influencing you to do that. So if you're not tapping in, and you're tapping in, you're constantly tapping into all these other resources outside of yourself, meaning the gang, the environment, society, you don't know what self is telling you.
Right.
That voice, because we all have, you get your that subconscious, that voice inside of you that's telling you, your conscious, what is good or bad, is telling you,
right,
it's telling you something, right? It's giving you those multiple options. But this is my perspective, and this is the psychology behind, you know, the way that I think. What happens to people like Queso, or kids like him, or me being in that environment working with kids like that, never that extreme though, I haven't worked with kids like him, is the volume of whatever the gang is saying is turned up so loud in their head that they no longer have an inner voice. And it's whoever's controlling that gang and telling the gang, like, this is cool, this is what to do, because they're gaining fame and notoriety, or what society's telling them. So it's a combination. He's getting it from both ways. It's like,
because society is affirming you because you're gaining this notoriety and fame, and people are seeing you. Okay, right. So you don't really have no other option but to think that what you're doing is what you're supposed to be doing.
Until they lock your ass up and you ain't got no choice. Okay. So once you get locked up, all those other voices turn down because they're not there anymore.
Because they're not there. And see, so it brings it. So I wanted to bring it back in to kind of close all around to, like, culture. Because at the end of the day, we're talking about the music, and the music is such a part of the culture that, like, we cling to, whatever. And I was watching another interrogation, and it was the guy, Scott, that we had talked a little bit about him before, but he's one of the associates, I believe, with the ATK guy.
Yeah.
Something I realized is, just like you said, like, the once you're by yourself, those voices get turned down, you know, and when you're with your friends and when you're with your group, that culture is what brings everybody together, whether it is the music, the things that you do together. And so you see him at some point, everyone leaves, and like the first thing he goes to is like you start reciting your raps, whatever you're playing in your head, you know what I'm saying? So if you're in this world that's always filled, you get what I'm saying? For, you might not even know, because you have to filter through, like, yes. the lyrics is like the first thing that come to your mind, you know what I'm saying? The lyrics is the thing that you identify with, and if the lyrics is murder, murder, kill, kill, and that's the way that you do it, but when you don't have that option, then what else? And really, how long does it take for you to kind of get past all the other stuff, the social, the society, program. The it's culture, the music, mm-hmm. exactly. That I realized that I was like, wow, because you know, you can see yourself in a situation like, say you're bored or something like that, or you're waiting at the DMV, you get a little impatient, you know what I'm saying? You might start reciting some your favorite song or something. Like, I see people do it, like, oh, you're jamming kind of to yourself because there's nothing else to stimulate you. You got to create your own. You got to create your own stimulus. You know?
Yes, yes, yes. And just to kind of flip it back, and I know we're gonna work with this timer here. Is being okay with being in a space of what people call boredom. And because we live in a society where you always have to be stimulated, we forget that it's okay just to sit. So I'm not bored if I just go outside of my backyard and I'm out there looking at the trees. I'm good. I'm getting that wind. I'm getting the sun. I'm chilling. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with that, man. When I go to the beach, I just sit, let the waves run. That's not boring to me. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. We have to realize what we're tapping into. And when we're tapping into real life, or when we're tapping into a made up life that somebody has given us. And I've had this conversation with you before, or I've had this conversation with my YouTube screen, screaming at my screen, that this is a life that that has been given to you, bro.
Right.
And you're running around playing a role and you don't even know who you are. Hmm. You know what I'm saying? And that's what it becomes, that life imitating art. Because we were in a position. We were in a position where art was imitating life, where meaning that painter is sitting down there watching, they're watching their position. I mean, they're watching what's going on in their environment, and they're drawing that still picture. Right. So that's art imitating life. We flip that now, because those guys who's making the music we talked about when I was younger and what was going on in the subliminal messages in the music, now it's just full blown. I'm right in your face with the drill music. And right. Regardless of if these guys were making things up, it's no longer that. It's now life imitating art. So now, since rap music has gotten a thing of being negative, talking about murder and killing, right. Now you have these characters, the Young Thugs, the Quesos, the Scotty, whatever. I don't even think he's a rapper. We just using him as an example.
We just so happen to.
It's another guy from Atlanta. I forget his name. His music is actually pretty good. Lucci, Wyatt, Lucci, and all these guys are in the game now. Actually living like these characters, man. And I call it GTA characters, man. I never really got into that game like that. I always thought it was a funny game. But that's what these guys are living, bro.
Nah, for sure. I definitely have played that game a lot. You get to do some wild stuff in that game, for sure.
And this is what I'm talking about. You have to tap into self and realize when you're living in a role of what somebody has given to you, or if you're really following your heart and the gifts that you have, because not knocking those guys, but they're young. A lot of those guys are young, and mm-hmm. and that's when you look for, I guess, that guidance. You know what I mean? And that's why a lot of those guys are in the game and stuff like that. But this is what I'm gonna do is about to wrap up under a minute. Mm-hmm. Anything that you want to say while we close out, and we can carry this conversation on again and kind of continue it on moving forward.
I just think, you know, we're talking about art a lot or whatever, and I think it's a respect that you have to have for something to call it like art, you know, and I think if we talk about art reflecting life rather than life reflecting art, you know, like I like to capture the good things, you know what I'm saying? When we talk about your mindset and stuff like that and being able to being able to manifest like positivity into your environment, you know, you want to pay attention to the positive things. So that's really all I want to say. It's about to cut us off, it's looking like, but I didn't want to go too long for the recording.
Yeah, so what I want to say before it ends off is, remember, life is a spectrum. So whether you want to measure something in a good space or in a negative space, it's what it is. You're going to see people die. You're going to see people live. That's the whole spectrum of life. So art is art in my perspective. Now, you can take it and say that's negative. You can take it and say it that's positive. That's a choice. You know, we can choose that. But like I said, we're going to continue this out. I'm going to do my little outro because, like I said, we all go through that roller coaster of life.